Good morning, Croze. How are you? Good morning. Okay, that's better. If we haven't met, my name is Doug Gaskell. I'm chair of the council here at Croze United Methodist. And whether you're watching online or with us in the sanctuary, we're excited you're here. By now, you've probably figured out I'm not Christy. It's the hair. But Christy is at the 100th anniversary of her former church, her and the bishop. You can't turn down an invite from the bishop. That would be bad. So she is out today. I'll be pinch hitting, but she will be back next week. Matter of fact, she'll be in the office on Tuesday. But no matter what, we're excited that you're here. And so having said all that, would you join me in an opening prayer? Holy God, in a world of anxiety and anger, you call us to be your instruments of peace. It is not an easy task, nor is it one that we feel equipped to perform. Prepare us, teach us, strengthen us, that we might show your grace, your mercy, your forgiveness to those around us. In your holy name, we pray. So I invite you to stand as you're able and join us in our opening song, How Great is the Love.
Thank you for the way You're still standing. Welcome once again to Crozet United Methodist Church. We're so happy to have everyone here worshiping with us this morning. I'm Joanne McDaniel, the lay leader for contemporary worship, and I'd like to extend at this time a special welcome to any visitors we may have. If you would, we'd love for you to fill out the small green card located in the pew in front of you. Give us just a little bit of information about yourself, and we'd like to send you some more information about our wonderful church family. If you have any questions at all, whether you're a visitor or a regular attendee, I'll be at the door when you leave and happy to answer any questions you might have. And now I'd like to invite the children to come up and join Mr. Doug for children's worship, and I'd like to invite the rest of you to pass the peace.
How are you this morning? Are you good? Is it a good day? Do you have to go to school tomorrow? You know? You do? Oh, man. I'm sorry. It's tough. So I want to do something a little different this morning. What I want to do is remind us of something that's really important for God and for us. Not just the kids down front, but the big kids in the pews. So I'd like you to repeat after me. God loves me. And God loves you. And that's important to remember every day, because that's the basis of our faith. Everything we do, that's what it's about. That's where it starts. So let me ask you a question. If you have a bad day and you're mean to somebody tomorrow, does God still love you? You sure? Excellent answer. Your moms and dads get gold stars. Check in with me on the way out. I'll give them to you. Let me ask you another question. Why is that important, though? That's an answer. The point is to go back and remember, God loves you, and God loves me all the time. And so if somebody is mean to you tomorrow, does God still love them? What are we supposed to do with that, though, if they're mean? What do you think? That's an answer. What else besides tell on them? Be mean to them back. Well, that's an answer the world would tell us, but that's not what God wants us to do. God calls us to love them even when they're not lovable, just like God does to us even when we're not lovable. When we're having a bad day and we're grumpy and scratchy and mean, God still loves us. And so we need to do the same thing every day to everybody, even when it's hard. Sometimes it's hard, right? Sometimes it's really hard. Well, let me do this then. Let's remember, what's the most important thing to remember? God loves you and God loves me, right? So can we pray? You want to repeat after me? Holy God, we are blessed by your love. Help us to share that love with everyone we meet. God bless you. You are rock stars. Now, when you go back to the pews, if you want, you can get a worship bag back there from Mr. Bart, or there's some activity sheets too, all of which is here for you. Okay? Thank you much. As we prepare for the gospel lesson, I invite you to join me in the prayer for illumination. Holy God, you give light to the soul. Pour out on us now the spirit of wisdom and understanding, that our hearts and minds may be opened to know your truth and your way. Amen. So today's scripture comes from chapter 12 in Paul's letter to the church in Rome. And it starts with verse 9. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves, never lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with the Lord's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. mourn with those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay anyone for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, "It is mine to avenge, I will repay," says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed them. If he is thirsty, give them something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not overcome evil by evil, but overcome evil with good. The word of God for the people of God. So what's this all about and why is it important? Well, scholars think that Paul wrote this letter about 57 AD. And this is about 3 years before the young Nero, he's about 16 years old when it happened, ascended to the throne. Nero wouldn't begin persecution of the church until after the Great Fire, sometime around 64 AD. So this is a time of relative peace and quiet for the church in Rome. But when you read this letter, it looks to me like Paul believes the church needs a strong dose of the basics. And so in looking at the text, Paul's words to me are pretty simple to understand. And a lot of times you look in the Old and New Testament, some of those verses are bare. You got to go back to a couple of concordances. You got to look online. You got to try to get a degree in Greek just to figure out what they're doing. But Paul is really very basic here. He's very simple. He's writing about love and action. And the actions we're called to do are how we live. He tells us to be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer, place others' needs above our own, share with those in need, practice hospitality, do not repay evil with evil, and live at peace with everyone. Paul's message is clear. We're called to be different. We're called to be instruments of peace, not just inside the church, but outside the doors, in the community. Methodism's founder, John Wesley, summed it up in two rules. First, do no harm. Avoid evil of every kind. And secondly, do all the good you can to extend grace and mercy to everyone. Most importantly, the Gospel of Matthew tells us in Jesus' Sermon on the Mount that blessed are the peacemakers. So you have Wesley, you have the Apostle Paul, and most importantly, you have Jesus telling us to be instruments of peace. And that's a bit of a unique idea in today's world. And in fact, when you go back and look, it's a unique idea in history. But what if we were to do something different? What if we were the ones to be instruments of peace? Not just because it's good and it's right, but because it changes lives. The problem is the world as we know it tends to pull us in another direction, right? The fact is, some of us, myself included, our sinful nature pulls us to a dramatically different action than to be an instrument of peace. We seem to be able to treat each other with an increasing abundance of abuse. We're experts at being condescending and hateful, abusive and cruel, not just on an international level or a local level, but on an individual level. And I think it's easy to fall into this. The world encourages us. In fact, it calls us, it drags us to conflict. And yet, as followers of Christ, we're called to something different. We're called to be in relationship with each other, to extend grace, to extend forgiveness, to extend mercy. And this is hard. At least it's hard for me. But we can do this. This is possible. We are called to be different. We are called to be an instrument of peace, to offer that peace, grace, mercy, forgiveness that comes from Christ to make a difference, to change lives. Now, to me, what's fascinating here is that Paul even writes this. Because if you step back and think about this, it's more than a little ironic that these words come from Paul. You can make a case that Paul certainly writes from experience in conflict. Paul, the man who grew up with a singular focus on Jewish law, and that was the number one focus, is now telling us that relationship is critical, not the law. Now, Paul's an educated man. He studied under one of the most respected rabbis of the time, Gamaliel. He was a zealous Jew. He was committed to every one of the 613 laws in the Torah. He's a man who made his name as the oppressor of the early Christian church, someone who vehemently opposed the church and everything it stood for. And then he has a conversion experience along the road to Damascus and begins a life as perhaps the greatest church planter in history. And so Paul, the zealous Jew, becomes Paul, the zealous Christian. And when you read many of Paul's letters in the Bible, Paul comes off a little scratchy, a little abrasive, at times abusive. He tends to annoy many of the people he comes into contact with over and over again. In several towns, he's run out of town. He is on the verge of being scourged or whipped until he uses his Roman citizenship to help him out of that trick, and he's imprisoned. He has a major dispute with his partner in ministry, Barnabas, and he's involved in a major conflict with his brothers over some very basic tenets of the church. Paul knows conflict, and yet now he's telling us the need for relationship in peace. Paul's message is clear. He's calling us to be different. He's calling us to be an instrument of peace. And when this happens, lives are changed. Now, all of this, Paul's history, the history of the early church, is why Paul reminds us repeatedly to focus on relationship. Over and over in Paul's letters, Paul reminds us that building and maintaining relationships are critical. So it's not just here in Romans. If you look in Galatians, he warns the church in Galatia against dangers and rivalry, dissensions and divisions. In Philippians, he warns the church in Philippi to agree in the Lord. In Colossians, he instructs the church to forgive each other as the Lord has forgiven you. In Ephesians, Paul exhorts the church in Ephesus not to indulge in corrupting talk so as to not grieve the Holy Spirit of God and to put away all bitterness and wrath, anger and clamor and slander, along with all malice. And in 1 Corinthians, Paul gets on the church in Corinth for quarreling and divisions. So Paul is telling all these churches the same thing he's telling us in Romans, that relationship is critical, that there should be no room for hate and abuse and cruelty and the excesses that come with it. Except the hard part, frequently that's where we want to go. When you read biblical history, you see that this has always been hard, this peace, to extend grace, mercy, and forgiveness to others. It happens over and over again. And you see it in secular history too. But still, we're called to be the instruments of peace. Now, there's a very practical reason for this. If you think about your world, school, work, family, nothing progresses, nothing improves without relationship. And relationship isn't possible without some kind of peace. But there's more to the practicality to this. As followers of Christ, our words, our actions, our deeds, our lives are witness to the world that is outside these walls. What you and I do is how they see the church. There's no division. There's no labeling by denominations. It's just the church. It's just Christians. And so the world is watching us. People judge our faith by the way we live. Several weeks ago, I was inside Fluvanna Correctional Center, just for a short time, by the way. They weren't making me stay. I was inside Fluvanna Correctional Center for a closing ceremony for a week-long retreat for the residents. And I've been to probably 45 or 50 closing ceremonies in assorted facilities for juveniles, for adults, men, women. And they are always really exciting because you hear the stories of how God is working on their lives. It's kind of like standing at the 50-yard line in a professional football game and be able to watch it all happen. But what struck me the other day was not so much about how God had worked in their lives. What struck me was the participants' description of how the team members, inside and outside team members, had impacted their lives and showed them grace and mercy and forgiveness. And it didn't seem to matter what the crimes they committed, it didn't matter what denomination they come from, or even if they had any kind of relationship with God. They talked over and over again, the residents talked over and over again about how the team members had made a difference. Those team members were called to be the instruments of peace in a world that doesn't see a lot of grace or mercy or forgiveness. And certainly not inside those walls. The point here is that those team members, those human beings, they made a difference. But more so, they changed lives. Now, you might not buy into that ministry, I get it. You may not believe in God reaching down and working on individual people. We can have that conversation. That's cool. But the one thing that is undeniable is that human beings, followers of Christ, made an impact on those women's lives. They did it. Those people. So how does this all work? How do we become the instruments of peace? Well, I'll give you a couple of thoughts, what my research, what talking to other pastors tells me. First of all, I think it starts with faith. Much of the world tells us that we are out of our minds to believe in a deity that you can't touch or speak to or feel or see. But yet for thousands of years, right, people testify to the impact of God, of Christ in their lives. And many times we will have doubts. Maybe you've had doubts. I certainly have had doubts. And there will be times where we're left to feel like God has abandoned us or maybe doesn't exist. We are not alone. If I were to mention doubting, you might throw out doubting Thomas. But there's a whole boatload of men and women in the Old and New Testament who doubted. King David, Abraham, Moses, the prophet Elijah, John the Baptist, all have moments of doubt. The difference is that they hold on to their faith. Even when times are bad, they hold on to their faith in the midst of that doubt. But that's not all. Secondly, it requires us to listen. This might be the hardest one. It requires us to be quiet and to listen. To listen to other people. Now, frequently, I think in this world, people believe they know the answer. But when I look at social media and I look in the press, I frequently believe we don't even know the question, let alone the answer. The interesting thing is when you look at Jesus in the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Jesus listens to people. He knows the answer. He knows the question, but he still listens to them. He lets them tell him his story, their story. You and I are not Jesus. At least I'm not. And so I have to listen. And I think if you look to the person behind you or to the left or to the right, you will see that you don't really know the burden or the concerns or the pain that they're carrying. No matter how close, there's something that we don't know. And the only way I know how to understand, to learn that, is to be quiet and listen. I will never have a clue about the things people carry until I am quiet and I listen to their story. Now, they will tell me as a part of that things that anger me, things that confuse me, things that just annoy me to no end. And I will believe that they are as wrong can be. But I had to shut up and be quiet and listen to understand. Thirdly is a requirement for us to forgive. Much of the world tells us when people wrong us, we need revenge. In fact, it looks like revenge and retribution is woven into our DNA. And if you look at biblical history or secular history, I think it bears that out. We frequently do some pretty heinous things to extract retribution. But we're called to forgiveness. And it's hard. But we have some examples. If you go look in the four Gospels, you see Jesus showing forgiveness over and over again. And some pretty dramatic circumstances, I might add. Jesus forgives Peter. Peter denies him three times, but Jesus forgives him. In fact, Peter is really one of the first leaders of the church. Yet this is the guy that denied Jesus. This is the guy that was forgiven by Jesus. And if you look at what happens on the cross, what does Jesus say? Forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do. That is the model. That's what we're called to. Forgiveness. Now, you and I get angry, we get hurt. These are legitimate emotions, and we got to work through them. It doesn't go away magically. But all the hurt, all the anger, all the pain that we hold on to, it eats you up inside. In the long term, it doesn't do anybody any good. In the end, we're called to forgiveness. And the fourth piece is prayer. In fact, maybe I should have labeled that first because I'm not sure any of this happens without prayer. We're told it's not just okay, but it's good to ask God for the desires of our heart. And we're called to seek forgiveness. We're called to seek strength and perseverance to build our faith when it's weak. We're called to listen to others. Even when we have no desire to, we're called to forgive when every fiber of our being tells us to seek revenge and retribution. But if we're really going to be serious about this, We also need to listen for God. We need to look for God's direction. That starts in those Gospels, to look what Jesus is telling us. Now, it's not easy to sit quiet and wait. I get that totally, completely. The whole world wants to take us somewhere else. There's a multitude of entertainment options available that were never available 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago. Busyness of life gets in the way, but we have to be quiet and listen for God. And the emotional baggage that we personally carry doesn't help either. Jealousy, ingratitude, bitterness, my personal favorite, cynicism. That's my spiritual gift, I think. All get in the way of what God, Holy Spirit, is trying to tell us. Now, the good news, or maybe it's the bad news, is we're not alone. This has been going on for a long time. The things we suffer from, the things we struggle with, you can see these same things in the Old Testament and the New Testament. You can see them in secular history. We, though, are called to peace. We are called to be makers of peace, to be instruments of peace. It's easy to forget who we are. It's easy to lose track of what's important. The issues of the day are important, but as followers of Christ, we are called to relationship, and we're called to peace. How we respond to the issues of the day, whether it's inside the church or outside the church, is important, but how we respond to others is critical. Some people I've read tell me that, the problem is simple. We've lost the art of civil conversation. Some will label this or blame it on social media. That's the problem. Some will tell us that the very heart core of our faith or our nation requires us to stand up and fight for what's right. But I got to tell you, I'm not seeing that in Romans. We are called to be instruments of peace, and that's hard. We're going to mess it up. People will reject the peace we offer, but we are called to keep at it. We're called to stay the course, to try and try and try again. Paul's message is clear. We are called to be different. We are called to be instruments of peace. Not just to do the right thing, but to change a life. It doesn't mean that you and I can't be passionate about the world we live in and the things we feel strongly about. It doesn't mean we shouldn't stand up and be counted for what we see inside and outside the church. But how we speak, how we live, how we behave is our witness to the world. We are called to be different, to be the ones that show God's love, not just inside the sanctuary, but outside the walls. Not because I told you so, not because Christy wants it that way. God calls us for a very specific reason, and that is for the people around us. Now, some will say, well, you know, he dreamed this up because of the election. And yeah, there's some applicability here, but that's not what this is about. Some will say, well, you know, all the wrestling and tugging and fighting and pushing and shoving between denominations or in denominations, that's the reason why he brought this up today. There's applicability here, but that's not the sole purpose. We are here today because we are not just called to be peace, but to be an instrument of peace, to be the one that reaches out to make a difference. All of us, every one of us. We're the ones who must show people what the love of God looks like. We are called to be representatives of Christ in a highly toxic, reactive, anxiety-filled world. We are called to be different. And we are given opportunities every day, opportunities to listen, opportunities to affirm, to strengthen. You and I might not change the world, but when we offer that peace, lives are changed. Just like we talked about at Fluvanna Correctional Center. We might not change the world, but if we offer peace to one person, then one person is changed. When you and I can show someone what God's love is truly like, then amazing things happen. Then we change lives. And after all, if you and I don't do it, who will? Change a life. Be different. Be that instrument of peace. May it be so. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. This morning, as we reflect on today's message, I invite you to stand as you are able and join me in the litany of response. Our world lives in anxiety and calls us to anger. The Lord calls us to be joyful in hope. The world calls us to impatience. The Lord calls us to be patient. The world calls us to be faithless. The Lord calls us to be faithful. The world calls us to take care of ourselves first. The Lord calls us to place others' needs above our own. The world calls us to repay evil with evil. The Lord calls us to love. The world calls us to conflict. The Lord calls us to peace. Amen. This morning in our prayers, we're going to do something a little different. Don't panic. We're going to do something a little different, and that is close out with the Lord's Prayer. And so as we prepare to go to God in prayer, we ask you to remember the McDaniel family and the loss of Joanne's mother, and the Shaw family, Marie, Angela, and Ed, as they all battle COVID. Let us go to God in prayer. Holy God, our minds are anxious, our hearts are heavy, our souls are troubled. Shower us with your grace in the midst of turmoil and division. God of compassion, replace our hearts of stone with the hearts of mercy and kindness. Open our eyes to the pains of others. Clear our ears to hear the anguished cries of those who suffer. God of generosity, transform our clenched fists into hands of charity. Strengthen us that we may embrace all of your people, no matter who or where they are. God of righteousness, equip us with a new commandment to grace. Give us the strength to lead by example with radical, world-changing love. Mighty God, you know us all, each and every one of us. Grant us peace so we may show the anxious, healing for the sick, comfort for the afflicted. Lord, you know the concerns and joys that are in our hearts. Hear now our prayers for those in need. O God, through the power of the Holy Spirit, enable us to love you more dearly, to serve others more faithfully. And now let us join together in the prayer Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not to temptation, Deliver us from evil, for thine is the power and the glory forever. Amen. Please be seated. As we come to the point where we offer our gifts to the Lord, we like to share ways that your giving makes a difference. And this year, we will spend over $13,000 for electricity. That is a huge amount of money. But it pays for the light and the heat, pays for the air conditioning, not just here on Sunday, but it makes it possible for groups to gather throughout the week. It makes the preschool possible. It makes groups like AA, the Scouts, exercise classes, Bible studies, and like everything else here, none of it happens without you. And so as the ushers come forward, I invite you to give back a portion of what God has given you for the glory of God and for the use of the people. Holy God, as we give today, we pray for your peace. We pray for strength. And we pray for perseverance. May this offering help bring peace to those in need, comfort to those in pain, and healing for those who are sick. And to spread your love throughout the world. And all of this we ask in your name. Amen. Amen. We now have our communicator in chief, the estimable Bart Isley. Need a fanfare.
That would be nice.
Ruffles and flourishes.
This one on? Okay, awesome. That would be nice. Like maybe intro music, like walk up music. That'd be, I don't know, something to think about. Something going forward. All right. This week, next Sunday, we've got the Crozet's Got Talent show. Our music and arts ministry is hosting the second annual Crozet's Got Talent show from 4 p.m. to 5:30 p.m. A talented group of performers will be showing off their incredible variety of talents in the Fellowship Hall with a spaghetti dinner to follow. This is a great opportunity to celebrate these talented performers and have a blast on a Sunday afternoon. The Crozet's Got Talent show was a big success last year, so please come out and join us for another fun-filled show. Also today, All right, so the United Women in Faith will hold their quarterly luncheon today in the Fellowship Hall after the 11 a.m. worship service around 12:15 p.m. All women are invited to join. This is a great opportunity to hear about the fellowship with this group that is critical to the life of our church. Also related to the United Women in Faith, thank you to everyone who took a tag from the giving tree in the back. That's phenomenal, and they were all gone after the 11 o'clock service. Anyone who took an angel tag for the homebound delivery patrons of Grace Grocery, please return your wrapped gift by Sunday, November 24th, with the angel tag attached so they can be distributed before Christmas. Thank you so much for making someone's Christmas bright. Church office tomorrow will be closed for Veterans Day, and the office will reopen Tuesday as scheduled. Also, we're looking for nursery help. Crozet UMC is hiring additional workers to staff our child care service during Sunday worship services and grow groups. These are paid positions that are so vital to the church ministries. If interested, please contact Bob Law. You can find his email, not there. But if you need it, email me. I've got it, or you can find his cell phone, or he's right there, and just talk to him. That also works. As we talked about last week and in the weeks before, we've entered a critical portion of the year for the church's giving. We're asking you to join us to restore and renew through giving this fall. After last week's giving, we now need $140,437 for planned ministerial expenses through the end of the year, facilities projects we've already undertaken, as well as current and future transition expenses. Take a look at our progress, and you can keep track of it on the tracker each week. Thank you so much for your consideration and continued support of Crozet UMC. It helps make events like this possible. Next, there we go. Like I said last week, it's not very often that you get to have a peanut butter sandwich meet a pirate on second base. So pretty exciting stuff. Again, that was the costumed wiffle ball event that the youth transformed into a benefit for hurricane relief, raised over $300. It's awesome stuff. That doesn't happen without, like Doug said, the utilities for them to meet and us to have high school youth group that we relaunched this year downstairs and meet and have a space. Your giving makes that possible for supplies, space for the mortgage, and utilities for us to meet. And not to mention inspiration. The United Women in Faith and Grace Grocery in particular are an incredible model for our kids and what they've done. So thank you so much for your giving, your service, and everything that you've done. And now our final, life song. There we go.
Bye.
Christ Jesus found in John chapter 14, because I think they're worthy of us to take with us, worthy of us to remember. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid. Go now with the faith in God, in the assurance of Christ, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
1, 2, 3. Let my love.